and a member of the regional executives. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome the ministration of Deacon Fidelis.
Amen. Hallelujah. This morning, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be unto you all.
Amen.
I want to thank God for your lives and your destinies. I want to thank God for the leaders of the church, pastor and executive, for giving me this privilege to share the word of God with the saints of God. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we bow down our heads in a short prayer? Father in heaven, we thank you this morning. We give you all the praise. We give you all the word. I pray in the name of Jesus that this ancient word that is holy, long preserved, that people must sacrifice, this word that lives and dies at home, will impact our life this morning. Pray that let every heart receive this word. May we really get impacted at our very core. We come against every item that will exalt itself against the knowledge of God. And pray that the human should be in our midst. We thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
This morning, by the grace of God, I want to speak to us on the team, living a resurrected new life. Somebody say this, I'm living a resurrected new life. And for the purpose of this topic, we are going to read from John chapter 12, the gospel according to St. John, chapter 12, verse 20 to 24. John chapter 12, verse 20 to 24. Amen. I'm reading from the New International Version. John chapter 12, verse 20 to 24. And I read, "Now there were some Greeks among those who went out to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. They said, 'We would like to see Jesus.' Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip told Jesus. Jesus replied," this one is right, "they wanted to see Jesus. And Jesus replied, 'The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seed. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life." Hallelujah.
Amen.
We want to jump to the 27. He said, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason, very reason, I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." Hallelujah. This morning we are going to look at the topic, living a resurrected new life. A resurrected new life is a life that goes beyond the grave. A resurrected new life is a life that is a product of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Bible said that for all have sinned. When we look in the book of the beginnings, Genesis, the Bible said that because of Adam and Eve rebellion, they are acted in sin, entered the world. When sin entered the world, man was separated from God. The image of God that man bear was tainted. It was marred. It was defaced. We became objects of God's wrath. But the God that we serve, who by foreknowledge and foreordination through predestination, he has set all things by his time, but it will come to an appointed time when he, God, he will descend, he will condescend upon the human form of his nature, and he will die on the cross, and through his death, he will overcome the power of death that as whole a lot of men and women who were created in his image in bondage. Hallelujah. And so we see that from the time that man fell, when it comes to Genesis 3 verse 15, the Bible says that God himself made a prophetic declaration, and he said that what? The seed of a woman shall bruise upon the head of a serpent. That word that God declared on it in theology is called what we call proto-evangelion. It is a prophetic declaration. That is mean the gospel that God spoke in Genesis, that it will come to a time that the seed of a woman, hallelujah, the seed of a woman. We understand clearly that women don't have seed. Men have seed. Men give seed to women. Hallelujah. But this time, a woman is the first time a woman will conceive. And this woman will have a seed. Mm-hmm. That is so unique about the incarnation of Christ.
Amen.
That's why in the Old Testament, when man fell, God, through covenants of diversity in the Garden of Eden, where God did a covenant, he killed animals, used animals as a covering. It was covering, it covers man's sin, but it did not take away man's sin. We see it came to the time of the Abrahamic covenant, the Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant. All this covenant was pointing to the coming of a better covenant, which will bring many sons to glory. And when Jesus Christ came on earth, the Bible says that when he was walking among the people, the Jews, the Pharisees, they did not see him as the Messiah. Why? Because their knowledge about the Messiah that they were looking for did not correspond to the Messiah that they had seen at that time. Hallelujah. They were thinking about the Messiah who will come and deliver them and rule over them. They were thinking about Messiah who will come as a God being who will stay at the holiest of holies, who will not mingle with sin, who will come and save only Jews. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But Jesus Christ proved them wrong. He began to mingle with men. With the man Jesus, who was attested by God for signs and wonders, was walking through the cross of Galilee, healing the leper, raising the dead, opening blind eyes, because God was with him. God anointed with power. He was breaking the Sabbath law. He was setting people free. He was allowing the leper, people who were unclean, to touch him. And he claimed to be a high priest. So they had a false view about him. And when we come to the gospel according to John is believed to be one that's on the non-synoptic gospel. Jesus Christ, he speaking to them. He said some of the Greeks went up to worship at the feast of the festival. We believe that we had that with the Hosanna. And Jesus Christ at the festival, some Greek came and said they would like to see Jesus. They told Philip. And when Jesus was answering them, he said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Verily, I tell you the truth, unless a camel, he said, the hour has come. People are going to see Jesus Christ. And because Jesus Christ was God, he already knew their thoughts. He already knew their mindsets, that they have come, that they will come and take him and go make him a king or for themselves. So Jesus Christ is replying to them. He said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Verily, I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, other version, unless a grain or unless a seed falls to the ground and dies, it will remain a single seed. And so Jesus Christ was using the analogy of the plants or plants of seed in response or in to give an understanding of what is going to happen at his death, burial, and resurrection. Hallelujah.
Amen.
A kernel of wheat. Unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, hallelujah,
amen,
it remains a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Unless one seed, so when look at the farmer, when the farmer goes to sow or goes to plant seed, when he sows one seed, the beauty of his produce, of his work, is seen when it grows, germinates, and bring forth much produce. That is the beauty of agriculture or the beauty of plantation of seeds. Hallelujah. If you go and sow a seed and the seed does not germinate, then you have worked, you have done a cosmetic work. Amen. He didn't produce nothing. But when he sow a seed, and the seed germinates, and the seed dies, and the seed grows, and it brings forth much fruit, then it means that there is what you have received a reward for your labor. And so Jesus Christ, using that analogy to imply his text, that as one seed, as one person, God has sent him to come and die, and through his death, to bring many sons to glory. The Bible says that for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son. He was the only son of God. The only begotten, the monotema or monogia, son of God. When Jesus Christ, as the only son of God, died on the cross, when he resurrected, the Bible says he became our elder brother. He was not the only son, but as many as believe in him, to them he gave them power to become sons of God. He was able to bring more sons, many children, to glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's all. Is that the hour has come? My soul is troubled because he's seen death. My soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this reason that I came to this earth. He subjected his will to the will of the Father. It is very important because sometimes, as believers, as Christians, we always want God to do what we desire or what we want personally for us. No, but Christianity is such that it is when we come into relationship, the life that you live is not yours, but you surrender yourself to the will of the Father so that God will do his will in your life. Hallelujah. If you don't live by the will of God, you will die. If you walk by your own desire, you will perish. Because as mortal beings, as we are friendly people, our thoughts, our inner inclination is checked towards evil and death. But when you surrender your life to him, when you let his will be done in your life, the will of God is peace. The will of God is perfect. The will of God leads you to an eternal value of your life. Amen. And so set glorify his name. And I would say that the voice came down from heaven that I have glorified it. There is death or there is glory in his death. In Christian countries, when you surrender to God, you produce much. In the world purpose, when you surrender, it is believed that you have failed. But in the context of Christianity, our strength is in surrender to the will of God. Our power and ability to excel is in our surrender to the will of God. Amen. And so the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, it is one and undisputable fact. That is the center of our Christian faith. Without the resurrection, Paul the Apostle said, our faith would have been useless. Without the resurrection, our faith would have been in vain. But when Jesus Christ died and was buried, he did not remain in the tomb, but he rose again in power and in glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the boast and glory of the empty tomb is that Jesus is risen. Transpedial. One transpedal, who was a theologian, said the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is one of the best attested facts on record. There were many witnesses to behold it, that if we do in the least degree to receive the credibility of man's testimony, we cannot and dare not doubt that Jesus rose from the dead. The resurrection is a fact. And any event recorded in history, whether ancient or modern, because as the church was growing in the early centuries, there were a lot of philosophies, theories that came up to dispute the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. And so we see that the church fathers rose up and they were defending the authenticity of his resurrection. Hallelujah. When you read some of these theories, we have the front theory. We have the swan theory. They said Jesus Christ did not die, he fainted. We have the hallucination theory. People believe that Jesus Christ wanted to see, the disciples in the future, so he must rise. So they, in their imagination, imagine to saw him. And we have what we call the myth theory. People believe that it was a myth. Hallelujah. By handed by Asian to the wrong tomb theory. So we have a lot of theories, a lot of philosophy that has come up with a strange worldview to counteract the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. But the Bible assured us that when he died, he rose again. When Jesus Christ died, he rose again. When the angels came, they testified that Jesus Christ was. When men spoke, the temple saying that Solomon believed to Solomon glorified, it was a testimony of his resurrection. Jesus Christ, after his resurrection, he ate and drank. He testified that indeed he resurrected by 500 men who saw him at once in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 6. The Bible said that they gave a testimony that Jesus Christ indeed resurrected. What is a resurrection new life? A resurrection new life, one, is a life of power. It's a life of power. Somebody say, life of power.
A life of power.
A life of power. When Jesus Christ rose up from the dead, the Bible declares in Matthew chapter 28, verse 1, the Bible says there was an earthquake. And when the earthquake, all of a sudden, the stone that covers the tomb, the stone that covered the tomb, the Bible says the stone gave way by itself. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. It brings in Israel the earthquake power. That power is the power that he gave us when he rose up. He said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto me. Behold, go and make disciples of all nations. That earthquake power dwells in a believer. So when Paul the apostle was preaching to the Ephesians, in Ephesians 1 verse 17 to 18 and 20, he said, I pray that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know the hope of your calling and the riches of his grace among the Gentiles. He said that, and for us to come to know that great incomparable power that raised Jesus Christ from death and has set him ahead above all principalities and powers. That power is the power that rose Jesus Christ from death. Hallelujah.
Man alive. And so
when Jesus Christ came as a God person, he did not sin, but our sin was placed on his account as the Son of God. He did not sin, but our sin was placed on his account. He was charged, they charged him with our sin. When Jesus Christ was buried, the Bible said that that shameful cloth, they covered the Bible. When he rose up on the third day, when they went to the tomb, they went and found that shameful cloth there. You don't come alive with a shameful cloth. You don't come alive with a bad cloth. Hallelujah. When he rose up with a glorified body. A glorified body. A new cloth. That means that when you come to Jesus Christ, he is able to erase all your past and give you a new life. It is a life of glory. It is a life that leads to progression. So Paul the Apostle in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 18 is that as we behold the Lord takes in a glass of milk, that veil that covered our heart, that veil of misery, that veil that makes us cry, is taken off. And when that veil is taken off, with an open face, you are able to see Jesus. The Spirit of anybody in you begin to have what an inward transformation from glory to glory. You begin to conform to the image of Christ. Hallelujah. When you come to Christ, every day of your life, you bring you a step closer to the glory of God. It's not a life of progression. It's a life of progress. It's a life of glory. And when Jesus Christ brought us to the tomb, that sinful cloth was left. That misery cloth, that cloth that was taken was left in the tomb. He received a new cloth. When you believe in Jesus Christ, when you resurrect with him, that sinful lifestyle, that past lifestyle, that lifestyle that men look at you and look down on you, Bible said that God took that life away and he clothed you with his glory. Amen. The life becomes a glorified life. Hallelujah. Amen. That body that he received, that body was a body that speaks of what will happen when we take on the new life. Amen. When we transition from this life to heaven, when Jesus Christ rose up, the body that he received, that was the body that we are going to receive. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It speaks of our future, eternal hope that we have about his blessed or sure coming. Yes, Jesus Christ will come again. If he resurrected and ascended, he will come again. Hallelujah. We have that confident expectation. That hope that we have in Christ is not a wishful one. Now, whatever we work with that probability, or maybe he might come or might not come. So I'm just, but based on a past experience of what has happened, we look at the future based on what has happened in the past. That indeed, God prophesied that he would come. He came to pass. He was incarnated. He rose up from the dead. When he promised the Holy Spirit came down on earth. And that it means that he will come again. And he said, I have seen him go. So will he come again. He will come again and rapture us. The dead and the living. Hallelujah. And the time was important for us to what? To walk in him. We'll look at the last 2 points. It is the resurrection, resurrected new life. It's a life of surrender. Hallelujah. Amen. It's a life of surrender. It is very important. You can say thank you, Jesus, for what you did on the cross is to surrender your life to him. Paul the Apostle, when he's speaking in Romans chapter 12, what did he say? He said, therefore, brethren, I beseech you by the mercy of God to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, not dead sacrifice. Was using it as an example, telling them that, you know what, the good thing that I wanted to do, I can't do that anymore. But the bad thing I want to do, because man himself was hopeless. Man himself was destitute. Man himself was dear towards evil. Man followed by Paul the Apostle. He found a solution. And he said, thank you unto God that Jesus Christ saved me. And so because of that, he took them a talk. He said, in view of all these things, therefore offer your bodies as living sacrifices to God. Because he has justified you. He has saved you. He has redeemed you from the power of the law. That law and custom that was against us, by and still against us, the Bible says that he knew that the cross. He has made a complete in him. Hallelujah. Therefore, we should offer ourselves as living sacrifices unto God. Holy and acceptable. For this is a reasonable act of service. It is logical. Hallelujah. It is a life of transformation. A life of holiness. A life of surrender. A life of complete commitment. If you look at what Christ did on the cross, you will never compromise your faith. Hallelujah. The people of Hebrew, they did not enjoy this text by the resurrection, but they knew that God had said, they said, they will not and if God has not delivered, we would never give up. Hallelujah. They spoke for their faith, and God saved them. Jesus Christ has died for us. He has rescued us. He has delivered us. We have that life of power. We have that life of glory. We have that life of productivity and increase. Therefore, we have to surrender our life to Him. Live unto God. We have to say unto the prince of the world and gain at Him. And the more we gain at Him, He will transform us to glory. And we learn that new life is a life of power. I pray in the name of Jesus over your life as you go out of this sanctuary. May the power of God begin to manifest in your life. In the name of Jesus, may the glory of God manifest glory. May it clothe you. May it even walk from greater glory to another glory. In the name of Jesus, anything that pulls you back by the authority of His resurrection, may you overcome that in Jesus' name. May your life be productive. May your life shine. May you live under Christ. May you become a pastor that men will look at you and come to Christ. Because you are the child of God. You are part of God. So you belong to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you this morning. May the Lord keep you.
Amen.
May this life visit your family.
Amen.
May this life visit the work of your hand.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
No devil, no demon, no power of hell can destroy you. You are born of God. You are God's chosen children. You are overcome the world. This is a victory. Wherefore God has highly exalted Him. Give me the name that is above every other name. And His name Jesus. Every name shall bow. Of things of heaven. Of things on earth. Of things on earth. That Jesus Christ is God. We trust in His name. We believe in His name. He died for us. We have to repent. Glory to God.
Amen.